What holds your heart? What stirs your soul? What matters come to mind? The cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not all wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. The years roll by. We wonder why we lost our way from home. Our father finds the child inside. We left for growing old.
Stop dancing. Morning. That's a wake up call. Well, welcome everybody to Chandler Acres Church. Those who are watching us online, welcome. Thank you for being part of our family. Let's pray and let's keep worship God and giving everything that we have. Lord, thank you for this wonderful morning. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for being our Father. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you have given us. Thank you, because we don't deserve it, but we know that you are with us and your love is so wonderful, so great, that you still love us and you are in this place, and we want to worship you and we want to honor you and we want to sing your praises, Lord. We love you and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's keep worship.
When he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong, put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough. Fear is a liar, he will take your stop you in your steps. Fear is a liar, he will rob your rest, steal your happiness, cast your fear in the fire, cause fear, he is a liar. fear. He is a liar. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love's all I fear. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Oh, let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. She's over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death.
Good morning. Good morning. You guys may be seated. We want to welcome everybody here to Venture, Chandler Baptist Church. Everybody online, thank you so much for tuning in today. If you have your Bibles, we are going to be in the Gospel of Luke today. And for those of you who do not know who I am, my name's Adam. I'm very honored to be with you on this beautiful Sunday morning. Pastor Dan and his family are out doing some family vacation, so we pray that they have a good time. So if you have your Bibles, we'll be in Luke chapter 18. I got a question for you guys just to start it out. Just something to ask yourself. You don't have to yell it at me, but does anybody have any like family movies? You know, like there's this movie you've seen 100 times. It's kind of like your family movie. You're sitting around. You don't have anything to watch. Let's put in such and such. Anybody got one of those movies that they watch all the time? Okay. We have a few in the Taylor house. We have a few. One of the ones that we watch and have been watching for years is the 1993 Disney classic Cool Runnings. Anybody ever seen Cool Runnings? We like it in the Taylor house. It's inspirational. It makes us feel good. If you've never seen the movie, it follows the story of the Jamaican bobsled team, which is based on a true story, where you have these individuals from the island of Jamaica, which is I apparently has no snow or ice ever, and they literally seek out to start a Olympic Jamaican bobsled team. And we watch these characters led by an individual named Darice Bannock as they go through the process of learn what a bobsled is, and then convincing the island of Jamaica that they need to compete in the Olympics, going to the Olympics, and then proving to the Olympic athletes as well as all those in charge that, yes, they have a right to be there and a right to compete. And we see them come up against oppression over and over again, and what's amazing is that they stay consistent. This morning I used them as an illustration that in life we need to be consistent. And we need to be persistent. And this morning, we are going to look at a very small parable of Jesus, a unique parable, as we look at all the parables that Jesus teaches about persistence in life. And there's good persistence and there's bad persistence. Amen? Good persistence is basically showing up and being present. There's also bad persistence. I'll give you two great illustrations. Anybody ever met the pushy salesman? Pushy salesman, maybe like a car lot or something like that. You show up and you're like, yeah, we just want to look today. I just want to browse. And he's convinced that he's going to sell you something, right? And he just continues to come at you and come at you. And eventually you're like, you know what? I don't want a car today. I'm done. You just kind of back off. Or maybe some of you have ever met the stalker. You know what? You're like, oh, no, she's got my phone number now. Ah, what am I going to do? You know, they just kind of keep coming. There's a good persistence and a bad persistence. But one thing interesting in life is if you want to be successful in life in any degree, you got to be persistent. Amen? If you went to Webster and said, hey, Webster, what is persistence? What is that? Webster would give you a couple of answers. The main ones would be such as, persistence is to exist for a long or longer than average period of time. Persistent is to be continuous in an action or a thought without changing or without altering your structure. Persistent would be to be determined, to be durable, and to endure. And in life, if you want to be successful to varying degrees, you have to be persistent. All of you guys have jobs. If you want to be effective in your job, if you want to have a good career, guess what you have to do? You have to show up every day, right? You have to do the job that you're assigned to do, right? If you want to get money, if you want to advance in that career, you've got to be there. If you have relationships and you want your relationships to be successful, whether they're families, friends, etc., you've got to show up. And you've got to more or less be the same kind of accountable person. Otherwise, you're not going to really get anywhere, and life is very much the same way. Today, we are going to look at Jesus giving a parable saying, when we pray, we need to be persistent. When we pray, we need to be persistent. If you would, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and then we're going to dive right into verse 1 of Luke 18. God of grace, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day, God, that you've given us to come together in the house of the Lord. I ask, God, that you would be with us here. And God, I pray that you would be with all those online, God, as we open your word, that you would help us just to be ready, be open to the Spirit's prompting, God, that you would help us to see and understand the message this morning, God, that you would just in love touch us, God, so that we would lean on you, God. And as we come together as a church, come together as a family, come together in prayer, that you would just meet us, God, and let us know that you are present in our lives, Lord. In your name, all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Verse 1 through 8 of Luke 18, reading from the New King James, it says, and then he spoke to them a parable, that men should always pray and not lose heart, saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, give justice to me from my adversaries. And he would not for a while, and afterwards he said unto himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest she will continually come and wear me down. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge says. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him? Thus he bear long with them. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he readily find faith on the earth? Now we have a unique parable from Jesus. Jesus has told us many, many parables. Oftentimes, when Jesus gives a parable, he does not give us the meaning of the parable, but today we are given the meaning. Even more so, when you read the Bible and Jesus explains his parables, usually the explanation for his parables come at the end, yet today the explanation comes at the very beginning. If you look at verse 1, it said, and then he spoke to them a parable that men ought always pray and not lose heart. And then he goes into the parable of these two individuals in this certain city. Now we have a stark contrast, right? Two characters, one is a man, one is a woman. The implication that we're given is this man is a man of authority, of power. He's a judge, so he's able to do certain things. The understanding there is he most likely is wealthy, and then we have this woman. She's a widow, and the implication there is she most likely is not wealthy. She's probably poor. She's not someone of great influence. She's probably someone who's vulnerable and in need, and they have this interaction between each other. And I want to break down a little bit of these characters. The first off, we have the widow. The widow most likely is our main character. Many of your Bibles will title this the parable of the persistent widow or the persistent woman. But a couple interesting things about her. We see this character is someone who comes to the judge continually asking for justice. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what wrong has happened to her. It doesn't tell us what her adversary is. It doesn't tell her what she's seeking. All it says is there was in this certain town a widow who comes to the judge continually seeking justice. Now, if you go to the Bible, one of the interesting things is there are many provisions in the Bible made for orphans and widows. In the book of Deuteronomy, we can read these, and if you want to, you can Google and you can see that. And there's a very interesting reason for that. If you remember, when the Bible was written, it was not written in the year 2000 or 2010 or 2020. It was written some 2,000 years ago. And at this time, sadly, women did not have the same rights as they do in America today. If you were a woman and you did not have a man in your life, you were at a huge disadvantage. Women could not hold down jobs like men could do. They could not vote. They could not own property. So because this woman is a widow, she is at a huge disadvantage. And the Bible has actually made provisions for that. Yet we see that this judge cares not for them. In addition, it's assumed that this widow does not have a son to represent her or have money to purchase legal aid. She doesn't have a lawyer. Therefore, she goes to the judge and petitions her case by herself because there's no one to represent her, and she's vulnerable. And we know she's vulnerable because of the actions of the judge. It says, for a while, he ignores her. Now, his job is the judge. He is supposed to seek justice on behalf of other people. But for a while, the Bible says he doesn't care anything for her, and why should he? She has no money to get lawyers. She has no man to advocate her. It's easy for him to push her aside. And the Bible tells us two things about him, and sadly these are the only two things we know about him in the parable, is that he neither fears God nor respects man. And because of such, he puts the woman aside. He puts the woman aside. We get the implication here that he is not an evil man, but a cold man. He's not a man that's wronging anyone, but he's a man that really just doesn't care outside of his own self. And Jesus gives us this parable this morning as a stark contrast. And we see that it is through the woman's persistence that her case is heard. So the understanding here for an illustration is, you know, the judge would wake up, he would walk out of his house in the morning, and there she is. Hey, judge, how you doing? I just want to know if you wanted to go over my cases. We're walking to your office. You know, he goes for lunch. She goes, hey, I hear they're having a special at the diner down the road. I just didn't know if you wanted to go over some of the notes that I'd been writing down about my case. And every day this individual is encountered with this woman. And Jesus tells us, I want to give you a parable here so that you understand that you ought to pray and not lose heart. You ought to pray and not lose heart. When we read the parables of Jesus, often there is one or more characters that we need to identify with. And this morning I want to ask you, there's only two characters in the story. I want to ask you, who do you identify with in the story of the persistent widow? Many people would jump to the widow, but I've got to pause you and I've got to ask you the question this morning. Are you the judge? Have you been the judge? Do you know of someone who is the judge? The Bible tells us two things about the judge. One, he neither loves God nor respects man. I've got to ask you, beloved, this morning, do you love God? Everyone is normally quick to answer, yes, I love God, but do you love God? Are there things in your life that would show others that you're someone who loves God? Do you love people, beloved? Everyone here would say, I love people, but are there things in your life that let you know that you love people? One of the interesting things about the judge is he's an individual who's in a place of authority. He's in the place of power, and there's someone underneath him that is asking for help, and we see that he ignores her. Beloved, is there someone in your life, be a family member, co-worker, neighbor down the street that's in need? They've asked you, and because they're not important, you ignore them. At time, it's very likely that at some point we've all been in a position similar to the judge. Beloved, I ask you this morning, are you the widow? Is there a need in your life, and you've been asking for help from individuals? Is there things in your life, and you've petitioned God? And you're still waiting? Are you someone who's vulnerable and you look to people who are more powerful than you? And you're calling out for help? Are you like the widow and you're petitioning and you're continuing and you're going because you know what you're seeking is correct and just? Have you lost heart? Have you gone so far and you say, it's just not going to continue? You've given up hope this morning. We read the parable of Jesus, and he says, I want to tell you this parable so that you pray and do not lose heart. Beloved, one of the most difficult things in life is enthusiasm, and one of the easiest ways to lose enthusiasm is time, amen? We get fired up about one thing, we're excited, and as time goes on, we kind of lose that excitement. That's one thing that experience helps to teach us, is that being persistent and being consistent. I'll go back to my illustration. If you've ever seen the Disney show Cool Runnings, those individuals face opposition all the time, right? The nation said, we're Jamaica. We don't have bobsledders. You can't do that. They continued. They go to the Olympics and said, you're Jamaica. You don't know anything about bobsledding. And they continue. In life, there is going to continually be opposition. The point this morning is that Jesus is encouraging us in life and in prayer to stay persistent. To show up, to be there, and to be evident. One of the neat things about this is why Jesus gives us this parable. If you read verses 6 and 7, it says, and then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said, and should God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night, though he bear long with them? One of the sad truths about this is I've heard people read this passage and say, see, if you want something, all you got to do is keep praying. Just pray and pray and pray and pray and pray, and eventually you will put so much of a tackle box, bear hug, hold on God, he'll just give you what he wants. Interesting enough, they get to that point by stopping at verse 5 and never reading verses 6 and 7. If you read verses 6 and 7, what Jesus is doing is, I want to give you a contrast. I'm going to tell you about an unjust judge who doesn't care about you and doesn't love God. And I want you to see that even though this is an unjust judge that doesn't care about you, love God, there's this woman who goes to him persistently seeking justice, and eventually he gives her what he wants. Now, I want to ask you that question. How much more would a good and just God do compared to this unjust God? Any of you guys have kids out there? Any of you guys big kids out there? All right? Yeah, sure. One of the interesting things is if you have kids or you were a kid, you often go to your parents or you have them come to you and they make requests, right? You know? And sometimes as a parent, you have to figure out, what am I going to do with that request? Am I going to answer that request? Am I going to ignore that request? I'll give you an illustration. Kid comes to you, it's 3 o'clock, I would like some chocolate ice cream. Can I have some chocolate ice cream? Well, you say, 3 o'clock, dinner. Dinner's coming up, let's wait. So what does the kid do? They continue, right? They persist. I would like some chocolate ice cream. Can I have some chocolate ice cream? I'd like chocolate ice cream. I'd like sprinkles on my chocolate ice cream. Can I have vanilla ice cream with my chocolate ice cream? Can I have cherries and bananas with my chocolate ice cream? I would like chocolate ice cream. Chocolate ice cream, chocolate ice cream. Can I have some more chocolate ice cream? And as a parent, you can do one of two things. You can eventually go, fine, and you can give them chocolate ice cream. Or you can say, I've already said no to the chocolate ice cream until after dinner, right? Now, the implication here is a lot of people take this logic and they put it to God. Well, you just badger God, and eventually he gives you what he wants. And that's actually not what the parable says at all. The judge says, I will avenge this widow because she's wore me down. It does not say, I will give this widow what she wants. Furthermore, we see that the widow is seeking justice. In the New Testament book of James, chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, James writes and he says, when you pray and you do not receive, it is because at times you pray amiss. The point of the parable this morning is to teach us that in life and in prayer, we need to be persistent and we need to not lose heart. And at times, beloved, that is a difficult thing to do. The point of the parable is that we ought to pray first and be persistent second. This morning, I've got to ask you the hard question, do you pray? If the point of the parable is to be persistent in your prayer life, the first thing we've got to establish is, do you have a prayer life? This is a difficult question, amen? There are times in the believer's life that this question comes up and it will trip you up every day. To the unbeliever, this is almost an illogical question. Do I pray? Why would I pray? What is prayer? There are many answers to this, but the most basic and most truthful one is prayer is talking to God. Here at Venture, here at Chandler Acres Baptist Church, we believe prayer is a communication and a two-way passage. We would say that in prayer, we talk to God, and in reading the Scripture, God talks to us. And like any relationship, if there is going to be trust there, and if we are going to grow in that relationship, there has to be a two-way conversation. Conversation cannot just be about one person doing all the talking and the other person doing all the listening. So when you pray, it must be coupled with Scripture reading. But, beloved, do you pray? Do you pray? Do you have open communication with God? Jesus says here in Luke 8, men ought to always pray. But that's a difficult thing to do. How would you pray? Well, in the Bible, there are frameworks that you can go to. You can go to the Lord's Prayer, pray something that's structured. You can also write down your prayer. I knew a few individuals in the past that actually didn't know what to pray, so they actually wrote it down. Have you ever had a conversation with maybe a coworker or a family member and you rehearsed it? Anybody ever done that? You know, I've got certain bullet points I want to make sure I get in this conversation, so I'm gonna rehearse it over and over again. I'm driving in the car, talking to myself, screaming. You know, the guy looks over at you and then hits the gas so he can get around you. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody ever been there? Yeah, you have. I've seen you. Don't lie. Prayer can be the same way. There are the old-fashioned answer is a prayer journal where you actually write it down. I've actually seen people that do it now on their phone. They'll make kind of a grocery list on their cell phone, but they'll put things to pray for. I'm going to pray for this individual's name. I'm going to pray for this activity that's coming up. I'm going to pray for this situation. And in their prayer time, they'll actually go to their phone so that they make sure they hit those bullet points. I've known people that pray in that fashion. They actually write out their prayer. Some people are uncomfortable when they pray because they feel like they're not doing it correctly, so they just don't do it. You don't have to always pray out loud. You can pray in your heart and in your mind. It's not something that always has to be public. Oftentimes, prayer is encouraged to be something that's informal and relaxed, and oftentimes it's something that is meant to be continued throughout your day. If you do you pray consistently? Do you pray short prayers or long prayers? Do you pray one day a week at church? One time a day at dinner? Do you pray when you wake up? Do you pray when you go to sleep? Do you pray as you drive to work? Do you pray as you drive from work? Do you pray when you read your Bible? Beloved, do you pray? I will be honest with you. I struggle with my prayer life. Maybe you're like me, but often I find that when I pray to God, my prayer goes something like this. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for this day. I want to thank you, God, that the sun is shining outside. Man, it's going to be hot today. You know what? I think I need some ice cream. I wonder if Hy-Vee has a sale on ice cream. Who was it that high-fived me the other day? Was that John? I wonder, does John have a motorcycle? How big are tires on a motorcycle? Are they small or big? Oh, I was praying. Anybody ever pray like that? And then you get back on track and you go, okay, I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray now. And you notice I haven't prayed a bit. I got Dear God in and then I left the whole conversation, right? You ever had a conversation with anybody like that? Hey, John, what's going on? Oh, hey, Adam, how you doing? And they're like, well, I guess I'm not going to talk to John today, right? No disrespect to any Johns out there. That's just the name I'm using. The Bible teaches us that prayer is something that's very important, but it is something that's very difficult to do. It's almost like if you're trying to lose weight or you know, work out and get exercise. You know, I have tried to lose weight in the past. One of the difficult things about losing weight I found is that you can't just focus on the dinner times of losing weight. You've got to focus almost all the time, right? You say, I'm going to lose weight, I'm going to diet, so you're going to cut down your dinner, but you've almost got to be mindful of it all the time. You got to watch out for those snacks, and prayer time is kind of the same. You've almost always got to be mindful of being persistent in your prayer. Being persistent in your prayer is not something that Jesus speaks about specifically in Luke. It is something that Jesus speaks about multiple times in the Bible. And this morning, I want to give you a few other instances that this is not a one-time occurrence in the Scripture. This is a multiple thing. 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 13, it says, "And as for you, brothers and sisters, never tire in what you do. Continue in that which is good." Galatians 6, 9, it says, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for at the proper time we will reap the harvest if we do not give up." 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, "Pray without ceasing." Some of your Bibles will say, "Pray continually." Ephesians 6:8 says, "And pray in the Spirit in all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep your prayers for the Lord's people." Colossians 1:9, Paul writes to the church and says, "For this reason, since the day we've heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you, continually asking God to fill you with the knowledge He has through wisdom and understanding of the Spirit." And finally, James 5, verses 7 and 8 says, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See that the farmer waits for the land to yield the harvest, patiently waits for the autumn and the spring rains. You too, be patient. Stand firm, for the day of the Lord is near." Philippians 4, 6 says, "Do not be anxious for anything, but in everything with prayer." Beloved, there's going to be moments in your life that are difficult. I would ask that you listen to the words of Jesus and pray. There are going to be times in your life where you have a situation and perhaps you go to the Lord in prayer and it seems like God's not moving. I would encourage you to continue to pray. Prayer is not something that is always easy, but it is something that is often necessary. Two final points about prayer is, often in our life, when we pray to God, we will get one of three variations of this answer. When you pray to God, you'll get one of these three answers, but of varying variations. One, God may say yes. Two, God may say no. Three, God may say later. You've probably heard a message similar to this. Go back to my illustration. You have a child, they want chocolate ice cream. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the child comes to you, "Mom, Dad, can I have chocolate ice cream?" You can say, "Yeah, sounds great. Awesome." You can say, "No, no chocolate ice cream today." You can say, "Later. Dinner's going to be in a few hours. Chocolate ice cream after that." That's an illustration. God may say the same thing to you. There are times in our life where when we hear the word "later," we often interpret that as no. Anyone ever had a small child and they said, "Hey, it's 3 o'clock. Can I have chocolate ice cream?" And you say, "After dinner." What did the child hear? They heard no, right? He said, "I didn't say no. I said, well, we're going to eat a good, wholesome dinner first so you don't just eat chocolate ice cream." But that's not what the child heard. And at times, we kind of fall in the same box. Beloved, there have been times in my life I have gone to the Lord for help, and God has said, later. But when he said that, all I heard was no. And it was often not until later that I understood what God was telling me. There have been times in my life when I was young that God put difficult situations in front of me that caused me great stress, great anxiety, and I did not understand then why I was going through those struggles until I got to a point where I was past that. And at that point, I looked back and said, God, thank you for giving me those difficulties. Thank you for giving me those trials. Thank you for giving me those tests, because now I understand why you've brought me to this point. If you've been in a situation like that, amen. If you've not been there, it's coming. Be patient, beloved. Pray and do not give up. The last thing about prayer is we are taught to be continuing prayer for two reasons. One, we're always to go and petition God for our beloved. Matthew 7, it says, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door will be open. Otherwise it says, you have not, for you ask not. I'll go back to the child that wants chocolate ice cream. If the kid didn't come up to you and ask for chocolate ice cream, would you know they wanted chocolate ice cream? No. One of the reasons that God wants us to pray is so that we come to God. But one of the other reasons we pray is, in prayer, we ask God for things and petition God, but in doing so, we find often that God works in our own hearts, changes ourselves. Prayer helps to mold our way of thinking so that we are thinking on things that are just and are right. Again, James 4, 2 and 3 says, when you ask and do not receive, you ask amiss. There are times that we make requests of individuals that we know are not going to come, right? We're either angry, we're frustrated, we're tired, we're just trying to be funny. At times we do that in prayer without even thinking. We ask not because we ask amiss. Beloved, we're going to take a moment this morning and pray. I want to encourage you that if you're an individual that says, you know, I've never really prayed to God, I encourage you that you take a moment and ask God what the whole Bible thing is. There are people in this room here that have been in the faith for a while. We'd love the chance to speak to you. As always, as I've shared in the past, Chandler Acres Baptist Church, we have a Facebook page. You can email us. You can text us. You can message us. We'd love the chance to talk to you if you have questions on what prayer is, if you have questions about what salvation is. As the music plays, we're going to take just a moment and pray. And if you'd let me, I'd like to lead. If you'd pray with me. Kind of gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day you've given us. I ask you, God, that you watch over us. I thank you, Lord, that you've given us moments in our life, God, of struggle, God, so that we may lean on you. I pray, God, that you would help us now to focus on your word, God. And I ask, Lord, that you would help us to always pray and not lose heart. We know, Lord, that in situations that there are going to be struggles, that there's going to be difficulties, that there's going to be temptations, and we thank you, God, that you've told us in your word you're going to be there for us. You're going to help us, God. I ask, Lord, that you help us have eyes that see that there are those around us that can strengthen us. I ask, God, as we come together now as a body of believers under you, God, both in this building and online, you help us to remember you and to seek you and to be men that always pray and do not lose heart. I ask, God, you be with all of us in this room, God, and on the interweb, Lord, that you help us just to remember you and to focus on you. In your name, all God's people say, amen. Go to the Lord in song.
My hope is built. trust the sweetest friend, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Come on, every voice.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ
got started a little bit late today, so we're going to put these two things together. In just a moment, we're going to have a time of offering. So if you're here, we're going to have some individuals stationed in the back like normal to take the offering. If you're online, there should be some information popping up somewhere on the screen. I can't remember exactly where it is. I don't know if it's up, down. So anywhere, somewhere, there's usually information that can help you out to give online. Lastly for that, quick announcements, and then we're going to go to a song and do our time of offering. A couple things. We still have Cooking with Laura coming up. Yeah! If anybody's hungry. In addition, be looking. We're going to have that Let's Fiesta, which is a time for us to all come together. We're going to be in the back here for some social distancing. There's plenty of room. So please tell your friends, family. We'll come out for a good time for there. And then the last thing is we're still doing the food pantry. This Sunday is the last Sunday for Sketti and Noodles. Starting next Sunday is Saltine Crackers. Yeah. So we're gonna do a quick prayer, and then we'll have the time of offering and a song, and then we'll dismiss following that. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given us, God. I ask, Lord, that you would watch over us as we go, God, and that during this time, Lord, you would just help us, God, to remember to give back in the greatness, God, that you've given us. I ask, Lord, that you would keep us and watch over us, God, and that this time we would just fulfill worship for you. In your name, amen.
What holds your heart? What stirs your soul? What matters come to mind? The cares you keep, the thoughts you think. It's not all wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your child inside. We left for growing old. Awake, 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 my soul. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming, there's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing, praise the Lord. Let everything, praise the Lord. In the working, in the waiting, let it praise the Lord. In the blessing, I've been thinking about time.